Hello, my name is the laziest writer, and welcome to this little corner of the. Okay, rude. What you're looking at right now, if you're looking at the screen that is an invaluable piece of history. The horror film was arguably invented by Georges Méliès in 1896, 5 whole years before the death of Queen Victoria, and only 16 after the invention of time. They've become quite a lot better over the years, which is by no means a refusal to acknowledge the qualities and achievements of the original, but rather a recognition that Méliès accidentally invented the jump cut and then outright refused to do anything else for a good 500 of his 1500 films. And the Haunted Castle wasn't even in the first 77 of those. Regardless, What Was Born has been a powerhouse of cinema for over 3/4 of a century now, and has constantly looked for new and innovative ways to expand and strike fear into the viewers who are no longer quite so terrified at the sight of a man wearing purportedly grotesque makeup. That search has taken us to some places that are very effective, and some that are less so. But something that I found to be at the very least interesting in every major example is the technique of legitimizing the audience's fear through connecting the events of the film to the real world. I don't mean those that are allegedly based upon true stories, but rather those that see how viewers are able to derive comfort from the separation between the real world and the worlds of horror fiction, and then launch an assault on that sense of comfort by turning said separation on its head. To our minds, the pieces of art that make the distinction between reality and fiction into its very own point of terror break through the barriers that protect us from the monsters and the killers of the nightmarish worlds of horror fiction. And I can't think of an example that does this better than the 1998 Japanese horror film, Ring. Spoilers incoming, by the way. The basic idea of the film is that there's a rumor surrounding this mysterious videotape, because, again, this film is 24 years old now, that has a curse upon it, whereby anyone who views the tape will receive a phone call that tells them that they have 7 days left to live. And sure enough, the bodies are starting to back up this ludicrous claim, which of course turns out to be true, but not after a lot of detective work by our protagonist, investigative journalist Reiko. In fact, the vast majority of the film revolves around her search for the truth, which is only injected with sporadic moments of horror to keep us on our toes, such as through the brief supernatural appearances of the murderous spirit Sadako, who uses her ghostly abilities to watch over her victims both before and after their death. The true source of the film's fear factor, however, is when it weaponizes the separation between Sadako and our own world by showing us the cursed tape in full. These moments place the curse upon us, meaning that if the tape so much as creeps us out, the presence of the curse will always be weighing on the back of our mind. Don't turn off the screen, or she'll be behind you. Don't look at any reflection, as there are signs of her everywhere. If there's even so much as a thought in your mind that it's creepy that you had to watch the tape, you won't feel 100% safe until the day after your week is up. They even explicitly suggest that you don't need to receive a phone call to be cursed, as Reiko's ex-husband claims that he never received one, and he... well, it does not go well for him. Our one element of reassurance that could shake us free from our creeping unease has been stripped away, and therefore we can't even look for comfort in the fact that we don't receive that phone call after watching the tape. Well, most of the time anyway. As such, there are key scenes in this film that are still truly terrifying to this day, despite the amount of it that is devoted to simply decoding the puzzle. Holy shit, I just realised that this would have made for a way better anti-piracy campaign than those "you wouldn't download a sausage" videos you used to get at the start of DVDs. Anyway, there are a lot of films and ways in which people have since tried to recreate the simple brilliance of directly forcing your viewers to participate in the activity that curses people in the world of the film. The following year, we saw the ingenious advertising tactics of the Blair Witch Project, which became one of the first films to exploit the viral potential of the internet for marketing purposes, and which, spoilers again by the way, claimed that it contained no elements of acting or fiction, but that it was literally found footage, discovered after three 20-somethings went missing in the woods. There were even fake documentaries produced and distributed to lend authority to the notion that the Blair Witch is really out there. And I would love to be able to look back on an experience like those in 1999 who had seen one of the mockumentaries or fake missing posters blasted over the internet and went into it not really knowing if it was a true story or not. But unfortunately, interesting and commercially viable as those methods were, they were inherently going to be diminished once everyone learned the truth, which ironically was itself facilitated through the existence of the internet. And nowadays nobody really believes that there's a monster out there in the woods hunting those who want to learn more. That said, a similar idea was used in the lore of the Slenderman legend back when that was a thing, and interestingly was used not in a way that was designed to reach as many people as possible, but in a manner that drew from the intimacy of being less well known. Because a part of the idea of the Slenderman is that he hunts those who look into his story, meaning that through playing the games, or reading the stories, or watching that utterly awful film, you're making yourself a target, and you don't even know this until it's too late. Everyone who discovers this element of the myth is inherently a target of the monster, and that creates a genuine source of fear, though only really on the small scale. This is especially prominent as, being derived from a creepypasta, the legend has a less concrete origin in the minds of many than the monsters in films do. They clearly came from the minds of someone who wanted to scare people, but this thing seemed to emerge as reality, with people telling their supposedly substantial stories online. That said, the intensity of this blurring of the lines between fact and fiction probably at least partially contributed to the real-world Slenderman stabbing, in which two 12-year-old girls fortunately failed to kill a friend of theirs in hopes of attracting the fictional figure's attention. So perhaps the outright attempts to convince people that horror stories are real are, in fact, flying a little too close to the sun. Instead, it might be best to encourage more of those that are clearly fictional, but equally use the usual disadvantages of fiction to inject further levels of horror into reality. There were many Ring remakes and sequels and knockoffs, including that one Doctor Who episode where folks in the 50s are having their faces stolen by a mysterious television entity called The Wire. No, not that one. But it wasn't until this year that I finally watched something that I felt was able to keep up with the methods employed by Ring, and, as you are aware of from the fact that it's in the title of the video, said thing was Marianne. Marianne is an 8-episode French series released in 2019 that was sadly cancelled by Netflix due to the chronic brain rot that has resulted in their refusal to invest in anything even remotely interesting. It has multiple language options for both audio and subtitles, by the way, so no need to crack open that French dictionary that you still have from school, for some reason. And it's definitely something that I'd recommend to any horror fans, managing to be part haunted house horror, part gores to peace, and part Stranger Things, but, like, darker. Oh, and yet again, there'll be spoilers aplenty in this section, and frankly, once I finish this sentence, it's fair game from then on out. So Marianne is about an alcoholic actor, author Emma, who has made it big off the back of her Lizzie Lark horror book series, in which the protagonist is tormented by Marianne, an evil witch capable of possessing humans. She's wrapping up the series to try and do something original, but is interrupted by a visit from a childhood friend, Caroline, who tells Emma that Caroline's mother believes herself to be Marianne. One series of unfortunate events later, and Emma returns home to investigate the well-being of her parents, who were highlighted as Marianne's next targets by the now-deceased Caroline. As it so happens, Marianne has possessed the woman in question, and the rest of the series is about trying to fight the witch's growing power. It's stylized as a novel rather than something filmic, which we are explicitly shown through the persistent image of pages turning and the show's events being written on the page at the beginning of each chapter. This serves to emphasise the collapsing of the distinction between the Lizzie Lark novels, which everyone in Emma's world thought were pure fiction, and the town where Emma grew up, in which the events from those books are starting to play out for real. But it also reaches out to our own world, and starts to work the same dark magic against the safety of our own reality. To Emma's world, Marianne's story is written, so it becomes true. She and her real, sensible, non-horror existence are thrown into the story of the witch, simply because she has published and therefore codified said story, thus bringing it into the realm of truth. The storytelling seems to have become a premonition of the facts, conjuring up something terrifying that she cannot escape, all because it is written. So the authoritative writing and validating of the story of Marianne, now in the form of a television show, which itself is divided into pages and chapters just like Emma's books, only threatens to do the same, reducing the three tiers of reality, fiction, and fiction within fiction to one plane of existence, in which we have to face the monsters of our imaginations. Kind of like those episodes of South Park, actually. And Marianne is aware of this, describing how she draws real-world strength from people's fear, which is enhanced considerably by the distribution of Emma's books. As such, the witch compels the author to continue telling her tales, threatening to bring them to life if she refuses to cooperate. It is even implied at one point that she is summoned into the real world as a result of this fear, like some twisted version of the Christmas spirit that makes the sleigh fly an elf. As such, viewers of Marianne know that they are creating her through their own fear, and that she only grows stronger in their minds, and they might fear, in reality, with every episode that they watch. It's a brilliant metaphor for that feeling when you're going to sleep after a particularly scary horror film, and feel the presence of the antagonist in the corner of your room, or under your bed, almost brought into our realm by the dread that weighs on your mind. It bridges the divide between the world where Marianne is harmless and the world in which she is real and deadly, and threatens to crawl through our screens and into our lives, much like Ring's Sadako does as she hunts her victims, and much like the phone call, or lack thereof, in Ring. The one reassurance that we might have is torn away from us completely. You see, Marianne's one real weakness is that she has to tell you that she's Marianne if you ask her. I mean, she can always avoid the question, but she cannot lie about if she is possessing a body. If we were to suggest that it should be believed that Marianne is being brought into the real world, which obviously isn't the case, but which is implied as a means of extending its horror, then the title of the show serves to confirm that she's here. Ridiculous as it sounds, if you look to the show and ask, "What are you?" in the exact same way that Emma asks those whom she believes to be possessed, you get the same answer that is given back to her by those possessed subjects. Marianne. Like Sadako leaving a trail of bodies, and her presence in the tape that we're forced to watch, Marianne sees beyond the world of fiction and into our own, and tells us that she's real. Thanks for watching. As always, I really appreciate you taking the time to watch this video, and I'd love to hear any thoughts that you might have had. Some of you have been subscribed for a year now, and I'm really grateful to you for sticking around for so long. Oh, and sorry for making you watch the Ring tape, by the way, but I guess that if you show this video to a friend, that will technically pass the curse onto them. I don't know, I never watched the one about the tape going viral on YouTube, or whatever. Anyway, thank you once again, and as always, I hope to see you next time.